Hello everyone. In the previous session, we have learnt about anatomy and other basic aspects of corneal tissue, and in today's session, we will talk about tissue engineering aspects of cornea. The topics that will be covered in today's session will be prerequisites for designing scaffolds for corneal tissue and polymers and cells that have been already used in corneal tissue engineering and commercially available corneal replacements. Let's begin with prerequisites for designing tissue engineering scaffold for corneal tissue. The first prerequisite is protection. As we know, the eye is exposed to external environment and it has to be protected from bacterial and other microbial infections. The outermost epithelial layer contains tight junctions and also microvilli, and it prevents from microbial invasion and And transparency, as we know, the cornea is transparent in nature. The transparency of cornea is maintained by hydration level of the stromal layer. The excess of water in the stromal layer is removed from the bottom endothelium layer by using the metallic pump, and thereby it maintains the transparency of cornea. Hence, the tissue engineering construct must have transparency, required transparency. The cornea is responsible for 80% of the refraction of the eye, hence the tissue refraction that is required for the cornea. And as for like any other tissues, the scaffold which we prepare for cornea should be compatible with the host tissue. And the most important thing is integration. The tissue engineering construct which we prepare for cornea must integrate with the host tissue, thereby not allowing any type of microbial invasion. Here are the few of the work that have been done on various tissue layers of cornea. And as you see here, there are many types of polymers have been used, both natural and synthetic polymers. As you see here, the full thick thickness cornea is is all 5 layers of corneal layer are tried to reconstruct in these studies. As you see, for these studies, cornea, collagen, chitosan, and synthetic polymers like PEG and polyacrylic acids have been used, and stromal layer of cornea are also tried to construct. And as you see here, there are many types of polymers have been used: keratin, polylactic acid, gelatin, polyglycol. We'll talk about all these polymers in coming slides. And various types of cell sources have been used for constructing the corneal tissue. For example, primary animal-derived corneal epithelial cells and primary animal-derived corneal stromal cells, dorsal root ganglion cells, and they have also used human corneal epithelial cells, human corneal fibroblast cells, endothelial cells, and human corneal stromal cells for as a cell source for constructing the corneal tissue. And now we'll talk about the various polymers that have been used for constructing the corneal tissue. The primarily used polymer is collagen. As we have learnt in the previous session, the stromal layer, collagen is the predominant predominant polymer present in the cornea, and it's present in the stromal. It's the main component of the human stromal cells, stromal tissue. The drawback of collagen is insufficient mechanical toughness and elasticity that is required for corneal tissue. And to overcome the drawback of collagen, they tried to cross-link collagen to improve the mechanical strength. And the type of collagen that is used has its own role. For example, type 1 and type 3 collagen hydrogels have adequate tensile strength and elasticity, whereas type 3 collagen hydrogels tend to be mechanically and optically superior. And cross-linking of collagen are done using using various methods that are classified under physical, chemical and enzymatic methods. Under physical method, UV light is been used, dehydrothermal method is also used. Under chemical method, formaldehyde, glutaraldehyde and genipin are used to cross link the collagen. And in enzymatic method, transglutaminase is used to cross link the collagen and thereby overcome the drawbacks that are associated with the collagen. We'll go on to the silk. Silk fibroin is the structural protein that is derived from the silkworm Bombax mori. The inherent optical property of silk fibroin makes it most suitable for corneal tissue engineering. And silk fibroin is used as substrate for corneal epithelial cells. Though silk fibroin provides a scaffolding material for epithelial cells, but its cell attachment property are not as superior as collagen, as it lacks the natural ECM protein. To overcome that, what they have done is they have introduced RGD domain into the silk fibroin membrane, and thereby they tried to improve the cell attachment property of silk fibroin. And compared with collagen, the advantages of using silk fibroin is it's simple to produce and modify, and as well as it's easier to produce the porous scaffold using silk fibroin. And we'll go on to the decellularized cornea. The corneal tissue, they decellularize, remove all the cells and the cell debris from the corneal tissue, and they use for corneal replacement purposes. But the problem is the availability of the human cornea tissue for preparing the decellularized cornea, hence are taken from porcine or bovine. And as it is a decellularized cornea, its optical and mechanical property are similar to the natural corneal tissue. And the approaches to decellularize the corneal tissue are listed over here. They use the various types of detergents like ionic detergents, non-ionic detergents, zwitter ionic detergents, and freeze drying and osmotic shock. And apart from these techniques, recently they have tried to use the high hydrostatic pressure and supercritical carbon dioxide. Chitosan. Chitosan is derived from the chitin by deacetylation process, and it has been reported that primary boveal corneal epithelial cell seeded on the pure chitosan membrane showed improved proliferation. The incorporation of chitosan can promote the optical transparency and mechanical strength of the collagen membrane. But the problem with the chitosan is it is very poorly soluble in the physiological medium. Hence, the derivation of chitosan has been tried out. For example, hydroxyethyl chitosan, which has a very good solubility, and also they have tried to use hydroxypropyl chitosan. The hydroxypropyl chitosan has a comparable optical transparency, and it has comparable water content and high glucose permeability compared to the natural human cornea. Although chitosan has demonstrated great potential for corneal tissue engineering, it is not used alone. It is blended with other polymer and hence used. So far we have discussed about the naturally occurring polymers. Now we'll talk about few of the synthetic polymers. The widely used synthetic polymer for corneal tissue engineering is polymethylmethacrylate. Polymethylmethacrylate is a transparent thermoplastic polymer which can be modified to achieve the required mechanical properties like toughness and stiffness. And PMMA, it has ability to block UV light, hence it is more suited for corneal tissue engineering. However, the usage of PMMA is impeded due to tissue necrosis, vitreous opacities and poor adhesion between the PMMA and host corneal collagen. Vitreous opacities, vitreous fluid contains 98% of water and 2% of hyaluronic acid. What happens is tiny clots are formed and they form in the eyeball and they move along with the eyeball movement, and that hinders the that is known as vitreous opacities. Several efforts have been taken to overcome these drawbacks. For example, coupling PMMA with PEG polyethylene glycol, and they also tried to combine other polymer polyhema with PMMA, and they also tried to improve the antibacterial activity of PMMA by using the antimicrobial agents into these PMMA polymers. And these are the few commercially available corneal replacements, and as you see here, most of the core material that are used for these corneal replacements are synthetic in nature: PMMA, polyhema, acrylic polymer. And as you see, the major drawbacks of these commercially available corneal replacements is integration, the poor adhesion between the cornea and the tissue engineering construct. Hence, future studies should be focused on to improve the integration of these tissue engineering constructs with the host host tissue. One more major aspect of cornea is corneal wound healing. Like any other wound healing process which happens in our body, even corneal wound healing involves four stages like hemostasis, inflammation, cell proliferation and remodeling. But the problem with corneal wound healing is cornea contains limbus region, and this limbus region is immune privilege and angiogenic privilege. That means it naturally lacks neovascularization and immune cells in the limbus region, and that is required for the transparency of the corneal tissue. And as you see here, the wound healing process involves the step called inflammation, and due to this, the immune cells march into the limbus region, they destroy the limbus region, and there'll be a neovascularization takes place as you see over here, and that leads to the corneal opacity. And in any other wound healing process, wound healing leads to the scarring of the tissue that ultimately leads to the loss of vision. And there are many attempts at angiogenic privilege and immune privilege of cornea. For example, amniotic membrane. Amniotic membrane naturally contains anti-inflammatory, anti-angiogenic compounds, and using this amniotic membrane for corneal wound healing prevents the or lessens the inflammation stage. And many pharmaceutical agents that are anti-angiogenic or anti-inflammatory agents are used for corneal wound healing to achieve the immune and angiogenic privilege, but at the same time exosomes are cell derived nanoscale vesicles that are secreted out and these exosomes contain several bioactive molecules that have various functionalities. The exosomes that have been released by corneal epithelial cells are known to involve in wound healing process, and uses of these exosomes for wound healing process for corneal wound healing are proven better. Thank you.